Good evening, everyone. This is Manas, your friend and tutor. And guys, I'm back with another lecture series on theory of machines. And yes, all your wishes have come true. A lot of students were writing, sir, please make videos on acceleration analysis. As I've already made videos on velocity analysis using the relative velocity approach, using the instantaneous method approach, students, well, they really messaged me a lot to make content on acceleration diagrams. And so all your wishes have come true and let's begin. Now, this is going to be a 6 lecture series. First 4 videos, well, it's mainly we'll be discussing mechanisms and how to make their acceleration diagrams, be it the toggle mechanism or be it the 4-bar chain, whatever it may be. And today it's going to be a very elementary class. We'll be analyzing a link, what sort of accelerations are associated with a link. We'll see all of that. Okay, just to do a bit of warm up before the real acceleration analysis begin, just take a look at this. What do you think this is? I'm sure you must have seen this. This is a pump jack mechanism, right? In some of the news channels, you must have seen this when they're reporting the prices of oil, crude oil, I mean to say, right? So this basically is the 4-bar mechanism, or a block diagram basically. And a 4-bar mechanism is sort of employed in a pump jack mechanism for the extraction of oil from oil wells, right? Okay, let's go further. Take a look at this. What do you make out of this? Doesn't this look like a slider crank mechanism? Crank rotating over here continuously, and this is the slider reciprocating, isn't it? And this is the block diagram, right? All doing good. Let's take one more example. And by the way, if you can tell me, what is this machine? What kind of a mechanism or a machine is this? Do let me know in the comments if you know about this. Okay, if we can zoom in slightly, please tell me what this device is, right? Anyway, let's take this session further. Here we go. What is this? Again, some kind of mechanism, isn't it? And what is this? Two gears meeting, one larger, one smaller. And in the environment of gears, we call one gear as the driver, while the other, we call it the driven member. This is the driver member, this is the driven member, right? Anyway, so these were just a few examples of mechanisms. And what we'll be learning in today's session is regarding a link and how you can work out the acceleration of a link, total acceleration of a link. And let me tell you from the outset, that the total acceleration of a link is composed of two elements. One of it is the tangential acceleration, while the other is the radial, or popularly known as the centripetal acceleration. You will get to know all of that, right? In a very short while, you'll get to know all of that, don't worry. So we'll be discussing all of that stuff. Here we go. The most important question, which might be tinkling in your mind, what is the need for acceleration analysis? We already did velocity analysis using two approaches. The relative velocity approach we used, and we also used the instantaneous center approach. Why do we need to go for acceleration analysis? Let's say you are a design engineer, right? You are supposed to develop some kind of mechanism for a specific purpose, let's say. Why do you need to know the acceleration at any given point in a link or a rigid body? Why is that so important? So this flow chart over here is going to really help you understand the need behind it. Let's really talk about this mechanism. Just watch. So at any point, let's say on this connecting rod, this over here is the connecting rod. We mark a point. At any given instant, let us freeze this, right? Let us freeze this. At a particular angle of crank, the connecting rod will be at a particular position. And also the slider over here, which is sort of reciprocating, again, it will be at a certain position. If you freeze it, then at that point, you can calculate the velocity using the velocity approach. And again, you can calculate the acceleration also. We are trying to figure out, why do we need to calculate the acceleration? Why is it so important? Okay, can we eliminate this step? Right? Can we ignore it? Well, we simply cannot. And the reason is, you'll see this. So if you know the velocity, you know acceleration, right? So after watching this session, you'll be very well versed with how you can actually make the acceleration diagrams. It's going to be very intuitive. Watch it. So if you know the acceleration A, then you can work out the external forces acting at that point. F equals ma, you know that very well. Elementary physics, right? Elementary science. If you know the forces, then you can also work out the stress. What is stress? Force per unit area. And to be very specific, it is the internal resistance offered per unit area. That is how you calculate the value of stress. Now, in a mechanism, you know, there are working loads. So due to working loads, there are working stresses. And these stresses are the additional stresses. These are the additional stresses other than the working stresses. So you know very well that you only, it's not as if you only have to deal with the working stresses. You also need to deal with the additional stresses due to these inertial forces, F equals ma. So it becomes very important for a design engineer to take into account the stresses generated due to the working loads as well as the stresses generated due to these inertial forces. That is the main reason, right? And people actually do motion study in software, such as one such software is SolidWorks. And please let me know in the comments if you want to know how you can do motion analysis in a software like SolidWorks. It's really amazing, right? The computer graphics are awesome. Anyway, so there are going to be two important reasons which you should note down. Number one, the stresses generated. These are the additional stresses, to be very specific. And you know, this is the acceleration, right? Centripetal acceleration, F equals m omega square r. Do you remember that? And from that, m into a is omega square r. So if omega, let's say, increases, initial value of omega is 10 radians per second. It becomes 20 radians per second. It becomes double. So if omega is doubled, then it's a square over here, then the acceleration would become four times. So what I'm trying to say is, acceleration plays a very important role, right? And it's very, very fundamental to the stress analysis of mechanism. As you saw here, if the angular velocity changes or becomes two times, then the angular, not the angular, but the acceleration becomes four times its initial value. And this is the reason why acceleration analysis of mechanisms is carried out before designing or working out the dimension of the rigid bodies or links, right? That is a very important and valid reason. Now, there are two points which all of you must remember for linear velocity. Remember this: for linear acceleration, let's say, we need linear velocity. You've got to remember this. And this is quite obvious. If you're a student of math, physics, or if you're just a science enthusiast, you should know, for linear acceleration, you need linear velocity. Similarly, for angular acceleration, that is going to be denoted or represented by alpha, you'll see that for angular acceleration, you need angular velocity, right? Now we can take this session ahead. Yes, we can. This is going to be a very beautiful demonstration. Do watch it entirely. What we have over here is a link centered at O, and this link has one more endpoint, obviously, point A, right? The distance is R. This link happens to be rotating with some angular velocity. At this instant, it has some angular velocity omega, and it is having angular acceleration as alpha. And obviously, the rotation will be circular, right? Let's say after some time, let's say we've got a stopwatch. Here, the stopwatch is showing zero. And when it reaches here, this position A dash, the stopwatch shows some time, right? Delta T, let's say. Okay, so obviously the angular velocity will change because of some angular acceleration here, it will change. At this very point, you are going to have the tangential velocity, VA. And here you're going to have the tangential velocity again, but it is going to be VA dash. Watch and listen to this very, very carefully. Okay. So this VA is horizontal, so you don't have to worry about that. What about VA dash? VA dash seems to be inclined at a certain angle with the horizontal. So if this is del theta with the vertical, so this is going to be VA with the horizontal. I mean, VA dash is going to make an angle of del theta with the horizontal, right? Just try to work it out. Simple math, simple geometry. I'm sure you can do that. Now, this VA dash will decompose into VA dash cosine del theta and VA dash sine del theta. And to make it much more elementary, let me shift this and form a velocity triangle over here. Let me shift this VA dash sine del theta to this place. So that's done. So you can clearly see the velocities are changing. This is the direction of velocity perpendicular to the link, and this is the direction of velocity, watch this, this is the direction of velocity parallel to the link. So velocities are changing in two different directions, one perpendicular to the link and one parallel to the link. So there are going to be two components of acceleration. As you know, by definition, acceleration can be seen whenever there is a change of velocity in a particular time interval. That is exactly how average acceleration has been defined. What we are interested in is the instantaneous acceleration. Okay, once again, this over here, initial velocity is Va, final velocity is Va dash cosine del theta. Here, parallel to the link, the initial velocity is nothing, but parallel to the link in this position, the final velocity is Va dash sine del theta. So this is exactly what our approach is going to be. We are going to work out the acceleration in two different directions. One, parallel to the link, where we are going to take this velocity into account. One, perpendicular to the link, where we are going to take this and this velocity into account. That is going to be our approach. So one, a radial acceleration or a centripetal acceleration we'll be getting, while the other is the tangential acceleration. Okay. Anyway, let's move further. Can you work out how these equations have been written? Va equals omega r. This is pretty elementary. And Va dash. So omega has changed. As you can see that there is some angular acceleration. How much? Alpha. So one thing which I need to tell you. Just like linear acceleration, there is angular acceleration. Remember this. Let's say there is a car. Let's say we have got a block over here. Okay. Right now it has some velocity. Let's say this is 10 meters per second. And there is an acceleration of, let's say, 2 meters per second square. And obviously, if this is the ground, then in this position of the block, right? Let's say the stopwatch reads time zero. Let's say here the stopwatch reads time t is equal to 3 seconds. Okay, if somebody asks, how much is the velocity at this instant? What is the velocity? Would you be able to work out? Yes, you can work it out very easily using some common sense and using the motion equations. First of all, let me show you using common sense. So this is 2 meters per second square, and that can be worked out as 2 meters per second per second. So in 1 second, there is an increase of 2 meters per second. So in 1 second, there is an increase of 2. So in 2 seconds, there is going to be an increase of 4. In 3 seconds, there is going to be an increase of 6. So initially the velocity is 10. So an increase of 6 will make the velocity 16 meters per second. This is 10 meters per second. That's one way, or that is the most elementary way of approaching a linear acceleration problem. And how do you approach it? From motion equations, you know that very well. Where the hell is my duster? Yeah. Okay. So the equations is very simple. VEV, right? Just V equals U plus AT. We want the final velocity. What is the initial velocity? Is 10, and we know the acceleration, that is 2 meters per second square multiplied by time is 3, and obviously this is going to be 16 meters per second. Here what you saw is acceleration, linear acceleration to be very precise, but what we are really interested in is the angular acceleration, and that can also be done very easily. The same motion equations are going to help us. Let's say you've got a link over here, and that's your fixed point A, and that's your moving point, and you have a lovely circular motion. And let's say we are right here. Here the stopwatch is reading t equals 0 second. Here the stopwatch is reading something t is equal to, let's say, 2 seconds. Let's say you have some angular velocity and some angular acceleration. Angular acceleration is 3. What? Radians per second square. That is your angular acceleration, alpha. And you've got some linear velocity, linear, not linear, but angular velocity. Let's call this as 5 radians per second. That's not alpha, that is omega. At this instant, omega is 5 radians per second. What is omega right here? Let's say this is our question. This is what we need to work out. Again, you can work it out using some common sense and using some rotational equations. you've got motion equations for linear motion or linear displacement. Similarly, you've got motion equations for rotational motion, right? That can be done pretty easily. Again, if this happens to be alpha is 3 radians per second square, so you can write it as 3 radians per second that means in 1 second there is an increase of 3 radians per second. So what is the stopwatch reading in 2 seconds? So for 2 seconds it is going to be 6 radians per second. So the initial angular velocity which we saw was 5 radians per second. So this is going to be added in this time duration. So the final angular velocity is going to be equal to 5 plus 3 in 2 seconds, it is going to become 6. So 5 plus 6 is going to be 11 radians per second. Beautiful, isn't it? That is the most elementary way. Now we've got the equations also that can help us. Just like you have this equation v equals u plus at, there is also one equation in terms of angular motion, angular velocity. Omega final, omega initial, that is omega at present, omega initially, plus instead of this linear acceleration you are going to have alpha, and time is time, does not matter what kind of acceleration you are dealing with, time is time and it always moves forward, never moves backward, except Avengers Endgame. Anyway, initial velocity, what? 5 plus alpha. Alpha, well, what is alpha? 3 multiplied by time is 2. 3 plus into 2 is 6. 6 plus 5 is 11. So 11 radians per second. You see this? Can you match it? Common sense and using equations. Now we are going to go ahead and learn more about accelerations. Right? Anyway, let's proceed now. Okay, so this was just an intuition to let you understand the sort of connection between velocity and acceleration. So guys, in between the lecture, you also should be making notes. You can also take the screenshot, keep on pausing the video in between and take these screenshots also, right? And later on you can prepare the notes once you have all the content. Anyway, watch this. Okay, I had to tell you this. This is the initial velocity at this position, v equals omega r, and this is the, at this position, the velocity, angular velocity will increase. Just like u plus at, you have this omega plus alpha del t into r, right? This is the initial angular velocity plus alpha into delta t into r. That's it. Okay, and this velocity you saw has been decomposed into components. That's quite obvious. Now our approach is going to be very simple. One, we are going to work out the change in velocity. You see, this is Va and this is Va dash cos del theta. This is the change in velocity. This must have happened for a very short span of time, for a very, very short span of time, and that is delta t. And in that time span, this link has moved by an angle of del theta. It's infinitesimally small. Okay, fair enough. Let's analyze. So one perpendicular to the link and one parallel to the link. These are the two approaches of acceleration. Here we go. Approach number one. Watch this. Change in velocity perpendicular to OA. Let me write something. I'm sure you have seen this. Acceleration. This is the way to express acceleration in the most fundamental way. Final velocity, initial velocity, and with respect to how much time duration has gone by. Right? How much time has gone by or passed by? Right? So we know the time that has passed by, it's very, very small, that is del theta, not del theta, but del t. Final velocity happens to be this, right? No, that's not the final velocity. The final velocity perpendicular to OA is Va dash cos del theta, and initial velocity is Va simply. Let us plug it in. What we are interested in is the instantaneous acceleration. So you guys must be thinking, sir, this does not look like instantaneous acceleration. This looks like average acceleration. Don't worry, we'll come to that. Okay, guys, there is something which I need to tell you. Instantaneous acceleration, how do you define it? From the very basic level, we know what is average acceleration. Change in velocity per unit time. In 1 second, what is the increase in velocity? That is your average acceleration. The unit is meter per second square. Okay, if you're talking about angular acceleration, it is going to be radians per second square. Let us focus now. What is instantaneous acceleration? So there is really no such thing as instantaneous acceleration. At any particular point, we won't be able to work out the instantaneous acceleration. So what you need to do is you need to cheat mathematics. How can you do that? You can do that with the help of calculus. What calculus? Yes, you can do that using limits, right? So watch, what is average acceleration? Change in velocity, change in time. So if you put the limit, if you want the velocity, let's say your car is moving from this point to this point, if you want the velocity over here, if you want the acceleration right here, how can you work it out? It's going to be very difficult, because at this very time, at this very point, the final and initial velocities are going to be same, isn't it? So what we do is we make 2 points, and these 2 points are extremely close. What we say is time for a very short span, delta t tends to 0. And what is this? This is nothing but dv over dt, and this is what is known as acceleration, instantaneous acceleration. In the same fashion, you can have instantaneous angular acceleration also, and that is something which will be working out very soon. For now, you just remember, there is no such thing as instantaneous acceleration purely, okay, on a pure basis. What we actually calculate is the average acceleration when delta t approaches 0. In the same fashion, there is no such thing as instantaneous velocity. It is the average velocity only, but for a very extremely small span of time, right? These are the basics which we actually learn, class 11 physics. I'm sure you must have gone through. Wrap it off. Okay, so we'll do that, don't worry. We'll put this expression to the test when delta t approaches 0. We'll do that, and then in that case we'll be getting this acceleration as the instantaneous acceleration, don't worry. So here we go, let us plug in the value of va dash is omega plus alpha del t r. Here we go, that's the expression. Now, as I said, we'll be putting this expression to the test when delta t approaches 0, and these two are infinitesimally small quantities, isn't it? So that's our instantaneous acceleration. This becomes dv over dt. You'll see that expression right at the end also. Be very patient and be curious to learn these things. Okay, here we go. So I've applied the limits to this expression. Okay, you cannot simply put the value of delta t as 0 over here. That's not the way we approach a problem based on limits. You rather need to simplify first, and once the simplification cannot proceed further, and that is going to be your answer. Okay, so when delta t approaches 0, we know that if delta t approaches 0, then this del theta will be 0, isn't it? It's approaching 0. So remember two things. If theta is approaching 0, then in that case cos theta approaches 1, and sine theta, well, you can assume cos theta as 1 and sine theta can be assumed as theta, right? So remember these two things. I'm sure you know this, right? Okay, so let us put this value as 0, and here is the expression. Take r inside, omega r, and this is going to be alpha delta t r. Omega r plus alpha delta t r minus omega r, omega r, omega r will cancel out. Alpha r del t remains, del t will cancel out, and simplify. Limits simplify. So we've got the first type of acceleration, which we'll be calling as your tangential acceleration, because of these tangential velocities, right? The difference in tangential velocities per unit time will give you this tangential acceleration. This is AO, that means of A relative to O, point A with respect to O. This is how you need to read it. And now if you guys are thinking, sir, how the hell have we gone from this expression R alpha to this dV over dt? Well, let me tell you, it's quite simple. Let me just solve it. Okay, so we have an expression F tangential superscript A with respect to O, okay, and this has been worked out as R alpha. Very simple, let it be R. How can you write this? Angular acceleration, just like linear acceleration A is equal to dv over dt, similarly, if you have alpha, you'll have angular velocity over here. So instead of v, we'll have omega over dt. Again, if you watch R times of d over dt, omega can be written as
वी ओवर आर, वी इक्वल्स ओमेगा आर, ओमेगा इज इक्वल टू वी ओवर आर. सो यू नो वेरी वेल दिस आर इज अ कॉन्स्टेंट, सो इट विल बी आउटसाइड, आर एंड आर विल कैंसल आउट, वॉट रिमेन्स इज जस्ट डी वी ओवर डी टी, दिस ब्यूटिफुल एक्सप्रेशन, राइट. ओके, सो दैट वॉज चेंज इन वेलोसिटी परपेंडिकुलर टू लिंक ओ ए, डन एंड डस्टेड. लेट्स मूव फर्दर, लेट्स या वी नो दैट रिलेटिव टू ओ. Here we go. Parallel to O. Parallel to OA. So parallel to OA, we don't have any component of velocity right here. Have we? No, we don't. But parallel to OA, we have a component right here. So the final velocity is VA dash sine del theta, and there is no initial velocity. So let's take it as zero. So we are going to follow the same approach. Again, let's make an expression for acceleration, and then we'll put it to the limits. Okay, so here we go. Final is VA dash sine del theta minus initial is zero. You have this expression. VA dash is written as this much, right? And let us again put it to the test by applying limits. Here we go. Done. Again, as I told you, sine theta becomes theta when theta approaches zero. So when delta t approaches zero, delta del theta approaches zero, and when del theta approaches zero, sine del theta becomes del theta. So you have an expression something like this, right? So you open the brackets, you solve it, and this is what you get, right? And if you watch carefully, this is omega r del theta, and that's alpha r del t del theta. Man, these are two infinitesimally small quantities, that is del t and del theta. When they are multiplied, the product is going to be even smaller, isn't it? This is going to be even smaller. So what you can do is basically, in the environment of mathematics, just neglect it and go ahead. So this is gone. What we are absolutely left with is omega r del theta over del t, and it's beautiful when you apply the limits to this del theta by del t. What you have is omega again, right? And omega into omega becomes omega square, and this is r. Here we go. Done and dusted. Limits simplified. So that's another component of acceleration, and this is actually parallel to the link. So we'll call this centripetal. People also write it as a radial acceleration. It's your wish. Okay. FC. In the superscript, name the type of acceleration. It might be tangential, it might be centripetal. So for tangential, you put a T over there, and for centripetal, you put a C over there, and then A relative to O. It's common. Okay, so the direction is from A towards the center, A to O. Okay, so by now we've seen two types of accelerations. One is centripetal, one is centrifugal. We'll go ahead. Let me read this. There are two types of accelerations which we have seen so far. And as far as link OA is concerned, FCA with respect to O, this worked out as FC omega square r, and you know very well omega is v by r, okay, v square by r square. So this can also be written as v square upon r. So this is our first formula of acceleration, or one component of acceleration. The second component is FTA with respect to O, and this is worked out as alpha r. Remember these two, extremely important. And these are the two accelerations that every time we have to work with whenever you are solving or rather making the acceleration diagrams of any mechanism, right? Remember these two. For calculating this centripetal acceleration, you need the linear velocity, right? Tangent velocity, simply. And for calculating this tangential acceleration, you need this angular acceleration of the link, right? So here we go. Graphical analysis. Let's do that. Okay, let me show you the entire figure. And let us, we'll be reading both of these points one by one. Just watch this, right? Tangential component, okay? Perpendicular to the link, perpendicular to the link. That's the tangential component. And this is parallel to the link, right? Okay, so this is FTAO, this is FCAO. And this over here, O1A1, is nothing but the total acceleration. This is the vector sum. If you are operating vectorially, let me just write this once again. Let me show it to you. So O1A1, here we go. O1, finally we are here. This is A1. That's the vector sum. This is A with respect to O. So vectorially, if I were to represent this, this is going to be O1 A1 is equal to O1 AO plus AO A1. That's it. Don't worry about all of this. This over here is the tangential component. This over here is the radial component. And if I were to calculate the total acceleration, it would be something like this. Ft and its square plus Fc and its square. Simple.
Let's keep things simple. Secondly, we are also going to talk about the intersecting point of the two components. One is the tangential, while the other is the centripetal. Wherever they intersect, you can write it as O with respect to A. You can also write it as A with respect to O, whichever way, don't worry, right? Okay, so the logic, the protocol which I am going to follow is whatever I write here, right, A with respect to O, the same stuff I am going to repeat here. Although in the animation, in the presentation, you were watching this as O with respect to A, but later on when I'll be taking up the problems, I'll always be writing as A with respect to O, right?
Okay, secondly, watch this, more analysis. Here we go. Alpha is 0.
It may be possible. If you've got a link and if it is possible that there is no angular acceleration, which means the magnitude of angular velocity will never increase. It will be constant. When that is so, that means when alpha is 0, this tangential component will become 0, right? So the total acceleration, this tangential component will become 0, and this blue line will overlap with this red line. Beautiful, isn't it? Similarly, when this omega is 0, if omega is 0, this centripetal or radial acceleration will be 0, and then this blue line will overlap above this red line, this red line. So whatever acceleration we'll have is the tangential acceleration in that case. So this was just a way to make cases and understand the beauty of the equation. Anyway, now let us proceed with a problem. But before that, I need to tell you how to draw parallel and perpendicular lines using two tools. One of them is the roller scale. I have a roller scale with me. When I used to study engineering, this is still with me. And some people also draw it with mini drafter. If you have it, better to use a mini drafter, because a roller scale, you know, if you want to draw a line parallel, so you can move it linearly, either this way or this way, right? You cannot move it along the plane. It is going to move in a linear fashion along a straight line. So that is one disadvantage of a roller scale, but it comes in very handy, right? So if you don't have a mini drafter, use a roller scale. And if you have a mini drafter, use it. Anyway, watch how to draw parallel and perpendicular lines. Before that, I need to have some water. So here we go. Let's say we have a point here, point O. What we wish to do is, we wish to make a line parallel to this link OA, right? And basically, whenever you draw a line parallel to a link, that means you are dealing with centripetal acceleration. Remember, centripetal acceleration, it is always parallel to the link. Tangential acceleration, it is always perpendicular to the link. Note this term. Centripetal acceleration always done or made parallel to the link, whereas tangential acceleration is always made perpendicular to the ring. And remember these two things. And let's have a roller scale. Here we have it, and you're going to roll it this fashion until you reach this point. When you reach here, draw a line. This is exactly how you make a parallel line. Now that's easy, isn't it? And it's accurate, don't worry. Let's talk about making a perpendicular line, and this is going to be very annoying, to say the least. Anyway, so you've got to place your roller scale perpendicular to this link, something like this. The approach that you need to follow, just watch. Let's say that's O, that's A, and what we wish to do is we wish to make a perpendicular line with respect to OA at this position O1. Okay, we can do that. So what you can do is this line.
So there are markings. There are markings. So place one of these markings exactly overlapping with this line OA. Place them. When you do that, move it ahead, draw a line, then shift it over here, move it ahead, and then draw a line. This might be a two-stage or a three-stage process, but this is very annoying, right? So that is why I tell you always use a mini drafter as much as you can, because that is going to move along a plane. Where is my cap? Anyway, let me erase this so that you can take a look at the animation. Here we go. Watch it. That's how you draw a line perpendicular to the original link, that is OA. That's it. Let's now take a look at a mini drafter. This is going to be beautiful. So it's not going to move along a line. Yes, it can. Definitely it can. But it can move along an XY plane or a YZ plane, whatever. Here it is. Let's have the mini drafter. Here we go. Right? Tighten. You first of all unscrew it. Loosen it. Then adjust the mini drafter until it is absolutely in line with this. Tighten the screw, bring it over to this point, and all set. Draw a parallel and a perpendicular. Bingo. So that's exactly how you approach making parallel and perpendicular lines. So let's begin now. Just take a look at this problem. Please read it. This rather is a slider crank mechanism. As I told you, our videos on slide on acceleration mechanisms, we'll be discussing a toggle mechanism, and we are actually starting off with the slider crank mechanism. We'll also be taking a four bar mechanism, toggle mechanism, and what, Andrew mechanism, if I'm not wrong. I read it somewhere. Where is that problem? Andrew variable stroke engine mechanism, right? Anyway, go through this. Just read the problem. And try to work out what could be the possible solution. Okay. So this over here is the configuration diagram. This will be given to you. Right? What you need to do is that you need to recreate this configuration diagram in your drawing sheet or your A4 size paper, wherever you are making the solution, you need to recreate this. Now, these dimensions happen to be extremely big. This is 1600 millimeters. This is 480 millimeters. 1600 millimeters means 1.6 meters. It's very huge. Not possible. If you take this original dimension and try to draw this in an A4 size piece of paper, it won't be done. So better to scale it down. So I would suggest you for this particular problem to use a reduction factor of 10. That means divide these dimensions by 10. This would become 160 and this would become 48. Right? And then you can implement it on any shape. But remember the scaling factor. Right? Okay. So first of all, you need to recreate this. There are three things which have been asked, and all of them pertain to the acceleration diagram. Acceleration of slider, of point E, and of link AB. Okay. Now, this point E happens to be an extended portion of the link AB, right? Extended beyond point A. So if you can somehow make the velocity arrow for this link AB, you will be able to work out for point E also. Okay. So the first thing which you are going to do immediately, this omega, this is anti-clockwise rotation. This has been given as 20 radians per second. So at point A, you are going to see an angular velocity, not an angular velocity, but a tangential velocity like this, VA. Perpendicular to this link OA, and we can calculate it like this, omega r. Omega happens to be 20 radians per second, put it here. R for this link A is going to be 480 millimeters, but plug in the value in meters. 480 millimeters, that means 0.48 meters. Here we go, and that's what you get. Let's do one more thing. Here we go. You also need to take a scale for making the velocity diagram, right? So what I have followed is 100 mm equals 9.6 meter per second, right? So the velocity component to start off is going to be in this direction. As the crank rotation is anti-clockwise, the velocity direction is over here at point A. Let's start. Why wait?
So these are the 2 points. Now only the students who have seen my videos on velocity analysis, especially the relative velocity approach, will be able to understand all of these concepts in a very simplified manner. If you haven't seen those videos, there is no point in watching it, right? If you don't know how velocity diagrams are created, then there is no point in watching this video of acceleration diagrams. You're wasting your time. And if you know, man, you're at the right place at the right time. Here we go. OG. So again, this velocity is in this direction, perpendicular to the link. Now you know how to make the perpendicular line with respect to a link. So make a line like this, right? Okay. So no baby feeding for you, right? In terms of bringing, in terms of having a scale over here, perpendicular to OA, then bringing it over here and then making a line. No, nothing of that sort. You just need to follow my instruction. What now you need to do is, we are making the velocity diagram. So the velocity over here is going to be in this direction, perpendicular to link OA. So you need to make a line like this. This velocity is VA. How much is the value? 9.6. So we have taken a scale. We are making a drawing. So we need to have some dimensions. We have assumed that 9.6 equals 100 millimeters, right? And better to rub all of this. Okay. That's 100 millimeters. Now what? Take a look at this. AB. The velocity is going to be perpendicular to this link AB. So draw a line. This is point A, by the way, right? B with respect to A. Perpendicular to this link, draw a line from here. Once again, try to follow the instructions. We've reached point A. Now we want the velocity of the slider with respect to point A. And this is how it has been placed. So perpendicular to this AB, you need to draw a line passing through this small a, like this. And somewhere along this line, we are going to have the point B. Okay, we'll get it, don't worry. Secondly, with respect to point B, not point B, but point G, or rather with respect to this fixed point G, B is sort of motioning linearly. It is reciprocating. Either it is going to go forward or it is going to come backward. If you watch, this is moving in the anti-clockwise direction, so it is going to move backwards, isn't it? So draw a line. So this is ultimately going to move horizontally with respect to G, moving horizontally this way. Now you have the intersection and that's point B, and let's have the arrows B with respect to A, this arrow, and this is going to be B with respect to G. So velocity triangle, whatever you may call it, velocity vectors have been worked out pretty easily. In any problem of acceleration analysis, the first task which we need to do is to make the configuration diagram and then follow it by making the velocity diagram. When that is done, half of the problem is over. You only need to work out the accelerations, radial and tangential, and then make the diagram, right? That is also going to be quite easy. Just follow these steps. So I'll take my own time to explain all of these concepts, right? This is the first time we are approaching the acceleration diagram. Secondly, watch. We also need to work out this point E, isn't it? How can that be done? So I've written something. Are you able to work out what is this? Point E happens to be an extension of link BA and it is beyond A. Similarly, in the configuration diagram, it is beyond A. In the velocity diagram also, it is going to be beyond A. So somewhere here, we are going to have this point E, right? So it's something like this. Let me make this diagram once again. This, what is this? This is point B. That's point A. And something like this. Okay. And what is this? This is O, comma G. These are the fixed points. A with respect to O, B with respect to G, B with respect to A. What we wish to work out is point E. So point E, obviously, point A, it is beyond point A. So it's going to be somewhere here. How far? We don't know. And this is going to be point E, but we know that. Point E is velocity with respect to this fixed points. This is exactly how the velocity diagram will turn out. You'll get to understand all of this very soon. What we've done is we've taken the proportional approach. Look, AE in the velocity diagram, AE in the configuration diagram, that's your LHS, is equal to AB in the velocity diagram divided by AB in the acceleration not the, but the configuration diagram, right? So follow this approach and just plug in the values. Okay, now you guys must be thinking, so from where have you got these values? AE, well, that's known to us, that is 4 feet 3, agreed. AB, that is 1600 millimeters, we agree. But from where have you got this value as 51.76? 51.76, what is this? AB or B with respect to, this is going to be 51.76. So I made this diagram initially on AutoCAD, right? So the values which I'll be getting are going to be very accurate. And if you happen to make this on a drawing sheet, your values are not going to be that accurate. Why? Because you're a human. I implemented this on a machine. That's why my values are going to be very accurate. Anyway, let me just show you. This has worked out as 51.76, right? And let me show you what it is in AutoCAD. Here we go. So here it is, guys. Just take a look. That's the slider crank mechanism. And we want this length, B with respect to A. This is going to be 51.76. Let me show you. It would be better if I can just have the dimension line. Yeah. How much? No, not this way. He wanted in a sort of inclined fashion. Just watch. I mean, making these videos, it requires a lot of effort, hard work, patience, research. Look, as I told you, that's 51.76 millimeters from the diagram, right? From the diagram, whatever you get is in millimeters. You can convert it, obviously. So let us go back to the presentation now. So that's the reason we've written over here 51.76. This data has been achieved from the velocity diagram. Just do a measurement with the help of a scale, keep a ruler over here, and you're going to get this value as 51.76. Obviously, you cannot get it. You'll get it as 51 or 52, but you cannot get 51.76. I did this on a machine. That's why I'm getting accurate values, right? So yeah, that's the logic. Just to solve it, you're going to get this value as AE as 14.55 millimeters. You don't have to convert this, although I have done the conversion, but that's not needed, right? So extend, it is beyond A in the velocity diagram. How far is E? E is 14.55 millimeters away from A. So extension, once again, let me show you. E is going to be somewhere here, 14.55 millimeters away from point A. Bang, that's E. And this is E with respect to O. Let's have the velocity. Velocity diagram is over. Now let's move forward and let us try to analyze the acceleration diagram. And here we go. Right, I've done all the calculations. This was known to us. Where is the highlighter? Here it is. This was known to us, and we assume 9.6 meter per second as 100, right? We made this velocity diagram and we got this value, this one and this value, right? You do the measurement with the help of a scale, and these are the values which you will get if you happen to take this scale, then only, otherwise not. If you want to do the conversion, you can do it. Let me just show you. What was our scale? 100 mm is equal to 9.6, isn't it? So 100 mm is equal to 9.6 meter per second. If that is so, then 1 mm is going to be equal to 0.096 meter per second. Is there a mistake? No, that's right, 0.096. But what I want is 1 meter per second. So what you do is 100 divided by 9.6. What is the value? 100 divided by 9.6. This is going to work out as 125, but 10.41. 10.41 millimeters, right? Again, why I am showing you all of this, the reason being very simple. We have this value in millimeters, okay? 51.76 millimeters. So when you multiply that 51.76 by this 0.096, you are going to get the corresponding value here, 4.97. let me show you. 51.76 multiplied by this 0.096 is going to give you the value as 4.968. So if you round it off to two decimal places, it is going to be 4.97. okay, so it's something like this. Watch, 51 0.76. What is this? Velocity of B with respect to A, isn't it? This is in millimeters, which we've got from this velocity diagram, right? So you can also write it as, say, 51.76 multiplied by 1 mm, isn't it? Now you know very well what is 1 mm equal to. 1 mm is equal to this 0.096 meters per second. And if you do this calculation, you are bound to get the value as 4.97. Yeah. Similarly, you can convert this also. Very easy. Anyway, now time to proceed. And if you want to note something down, I'll move away. Do note it. Take a screenshot. That is a better option. Okay. So we've implemented it as well, and let's get the pointer back. Yeah. Now, watch. So these are the velocities. You know, two things. One is radial velocity or centripetal, not radial velocity, but radial acceleration. Okay. Remember this. FC, any link, and FT, any link. This is going to be alpha r, this is going to be omega square r. Remember these two, or better to use this formula, v square upon r. Drill this inside your memory right now. Drill it. Centripetal acceleration, v square over r. The inputs which you need to calculate this centripetal acceleration is v square. Okay, and you already know the length of the link that has been provided to you in the acceleration diagram. It's quite easy, right? So if you know the velocities, you can work out the centripetal acceleration. And in most of the problems, you'll see this, that we initially go for the centripetal acceleration calculations. Why? The reason being very simple. We have already made the velocity diagram. So we know the velocities. We one by one for each and every link, we'll put the velocity over here, and corresponding to that link, we'll have the centripetal acceleration. Well, it is possible that some of the links might be having angular accelerations also. If you know the angular acceleration, then plug it in. You'll get the angular tangential acceleration. And especially in some of the problems, you'll see for a crank, in some cases, only angular velocity will be given. But in some cases, angular velocity along with angular accelerations will be given. So in that case, it will have two components, one radial or centripetal, one tangential. If only angular velocity is given for the crank, let me tell you, for the crank, if only angular velocity is given, it will only have one component of acceleration. Let's say the total acceleration will be centripetal. We've discussed about it, right? So v square by r is centripetal acceleration, and alpha r is tangential acceleration. Remember. So the fun begins now. Here we go. Let's make a table. This is going to be a very systematic approach, and I'm sure you're going to love it. Okay. Let's have the highlighter back. FCAO. What is this? V square by R. CA with respect to O. A with respect to O. From the velocity triangle, we've already calculated this 9.6, isn't it? We are going to plug it in over here. And this OA is already known to us, that is 480, isn't it? But this is in millimeters, so you're going to put the value as 0.48. Do the calculation, this is what you get. Easy. Now let's talk about B with respect to A. B with respect to A is 4.97. Okay, so if you wish to find the centripetal acceleration, it is V square upon R. V square for B with respect to A is 4.97, that's 4.97 divided by R. The length of the link is 1600, so 1.6 meters. Do the calculation, you are going to get the value as 15.44. Well, by the way, the values of acceleration, be it FC or FT, be it centripetal or tangential, they are in meters per second square. That's for sure. Okay, now talking about this FTBA, well, we have no data about it. With respect to this link AB, we have no data, right? So we can only work out the centripetal acceleration, that is the component of acceleration acting along the link. This is B with respect to A. That means it is going to be towards this A, towards A. Okay, Now, we don't know nothing about tangential acceleration. And as far as FBG is concerned, again, we don't know anything. This is going to be linear acceleration, as the slider is having sort of a linear motion. So that's all we can work out. That's all we can infer from all the data that we have. Now, let us move forward and let us start making the acceleration diagrams. Here we go. Fixed, O and G. Fixed them. We are going to start off with this FCAO. FCAO, it is centripetal, that means parallel to the link and centered towards O. Centered towards O, that is the sense. Okay, all the things have been written parallel to OA as it is centripetal. Wherever you see the C, you will see parallel written over here. And with respect to that link, with respect to A, that is senses towards A. With respect to O, that means the senses towards O. Fire, fair enough. And wherever you see this T, you're going to see this direction is going to be perpendicular to that link. Anyway, FCAO, centripetal acceleration, we've already done the calculation and we've assumed that 192 meter per second square is equivalent to 100 millimeters. That is our scale. Parallel to this, draw a line. Here we go. This is going to be A with respect to O, right? But again, you see, there is no angular acceleration given to us in the problem. Therefore, this is the total acceleration FC. As I told you, if alpha is equal to 0, there is going to be no tangential acceleration. The total acceleration will be the centripetal acceleration. Go back to the video and watch it again, right? And don't worry, you'll follow it very soon. Okay, so that's A1 for you. So we've got O, O1, A, A1. Now, what we wish to locate is point B with respect to both A as well as G, right? That can be done. If you see a pattern in the configuration diagram, all the points have been marked with capital letters. In the velocity diagram, I used small letters A, B, C. But in the acceleration diagram, I'm going to be using A with a subscript 1, B with a subscript 1, right? And that's the protocol which all of you should be following. Anyway, so that was about A. AB, centripetal, how much? 15.44. Now you need to do the conversion. This is 15.44 meters per second square. So what you need to do is you need to do the conversion. So watch, 100 mm is 192 meter per second square. 100 mm is 192 meters per second square. So 1 mm is going to be equal to, divide that by 100, this is going to be 1.92 meters per second square. But what if I want 1 meter per second square? So you divide this 100 by 192. What is the value? 100 divided by 192, what we get is 25 over 46, that is 0.5208, 0.521 approximately. 0.521, this is millimeters. Now, why I'm telling you this, the reason being very simple, what we have is this 15.44, the unit is meters per second square. So we need to do the conversion, you need to convert it so that you can fit it in the acceleration diagram, right? The acceleration diagram only will have inputs in millimeters. Okay, so this is 15.44 meter per second square. This is going to be 15.44, 1 meter per second square is equal to 0.521. Just try to do the math. Let me do it. Multiplied by 15.44, this is going to work out as 8.04 millimeters. 8.04 millimeters. So just take it as 8 mm. Right? How you are going to implement 8.04 mm in your sheets, in your copy, wherever you are making this diagram. Right? If you're doing it manually, there is no way you can place this value 8.04 mm. Yeah, but in a software like AutoCAD, well, you can input this. Right? Again, AB. What are we talking about? Centripetal acceleration. So it is going to be parallel to AB. Let me rub this. Yeah. It's going to be parallel to AB. So parallel to AB. And towards A, that means this direction, left hand side, towards this direction, left hand side. Here we go. The small distance that you see, right, that was 8.04 millimeters. Okay, so now you've got this point B with respect to A, right? So this is the centripetal acceleration of link AB. Now what we need to work out is the tangential acceleration, and obviously if this is the centripetal, then tangential will be perpendicular to it. So what you need to do is you need to make a line perpendicular to this red color line you see over here. Make a line perpendicular, right? You can extend it in the backward direction also, but I know already that I am going to find this point B right here, right? You don't do that. Make a line perpendicular to this line, and then point B happens to be in a sort of linear motion with respect to G, isn't it? So obviously if this crank is moving in this direction anti-clockwise, this point A will shift slightly towards the left, this point B will shift slightly towards the left, so towards the left. There you go, done. Acceleration of B with respect to G, B with respect to G. Okay, and one more thing which we can do, this is in red color. Link AB happens to be in red color. This is the centripetal parallel to link AB, and this is the tangential perpendicular to link AB, and we can have the total acceleration also. Okay, like this. This is the total acceleration, right? Squared using Pythagoras, you can find this total acceleration, and you, from the graph also you can work it out. Just try to measure how much this mm line is, the solid line that you see, then convert it into meters per second square, and that is your total acceleration, right? That's done. But there is another point, point E. Again, we are going to follow the same logic. Let me show you. A1, E1. So E1 is going to be somewhere here. I'm sure this is B1, this is A1. So beyond A, it's going to be somewhere here. The exact location again can be found by this simple logic. A1, E1 in velocity divided by AE in configuration is equal to A1, B1 from the velocity divided by AB in the configuration. Just plug in all the values. This is known, this is known. 87.87. If you measure this, and if you have taken this scale, if you measure this, this value will be working out as 87.87. Let me show you. Yeah, so watch this. This is B1 and that's A1. If we can just measure it, this where is the dimensioning from this point over here to this point? That's 87.87. That's exactly what I told, right? Go back to the slide once again. Okay, so you just need to solve it. That is 24.71 and that's done. So you need to extend this line A1 B1 here by 24.11. 24.71, right? Let me show that to you. 24.71 here in this direction, along this length in this direction, 24.71, and you get a point as E1. E1, join it with this fixation, that is O1 and G1. That is the absolute acceleration of point E1, FE with respect to O. Done. So the problem is 95% done. Only calculation is left. So let's proceed with the calculation. Let me show you. Here we go. Okay, all the diagrams in one picture. Acceleration of slider at B. Fine. For acceleration of slider B, let's say. Watch. We are interested in acceleration of the slider. So this slider happens to be motioning horizontally. Yeah, or reciprocating, let's say. So this is the acceleration of the slider. What is the kind of acceleration, if somebody asks, you would answer, sir, it is linear acceleration. Just measure this length. This is going to work out as something. What is that something? Let me tell you, this is going to work out as 35.13 millimeters. So this is in millimeters, right? I've got this value from AutoCAD. You are going to get this value from the drawing that you have made in the sheet, in the paper. Right, this is 35.13 millimeters, and 1 millimeter, if you watch, I wrote this somewhere, it is equal to 1.92 meter per second square, isn't it? Just do the math. 1 millimeter is going to be equal to 1.92 meter per second square. Just plug it in over here. You're going to get this corresponding value in meters per second square. Okay, so that was slider acceleration. If you want the direction, left hand side. Brilliant. Acceleration of point E. Well, if you watch point E, where is it? You need to measure this length with respect to this fixed point. You need to measure this length. If you do that, you are going to get the corresponding value in millimeters. So this is what we get. 123.48, quite big. 1 mm is equal to 1.92 meter per second square from this conversion. just plug it in, this is what you get, right? Very easy. Angular acceleration. So we are supposed to find the angular acceleration next of link AB. Need to tell you something. Angular accelerations, alpha. When alpha is multiplied by r, you get the tangential acceleration. So if you can calculate this tangential acceleration, and when you divide that tangential acceleration by the length of the link, you are going to get this angular acceleration. Beautiful, isn't it? So your task right now, you need to observe which link is it talking about. It is talking about link AB. So this is going to be alpha AB is going to be in the division. This is the length of the link. This is going to be AB. And whenever you are talking about angular acceleration, you need to take this FT, and this is going to be B with respect to A, right? So from the diagram, you need to calculate this value. First of all, if you have this value, then divided by this AB, you're going to get the angular acceleration. It's that simple. Okay, let me rub this again. Here we go. Task number one is to find your tangential acceleration, FTBA. Just place your scale over here and try to measure how much this is going to work out as. This is working out as 87.5. Convert it, this is 168, right? And when this FTBA is divided by this length AB, that is 1.6 meters, right? Simple, isn't it? Alpha R, right? You divide it by 1.6. Going to get the value of alpha, that's 105 radians per second square. So if you're still watching the video, thumbs up from my side. And thank you for being patient. I mean, these things are really complex, and you'll see the level of difficulty rising gradually. Yes, this is complex stuff, and you need to have a lot of patience, a lot of focus when you are studying the subject of theory of machines here. It really is complex, right? But I'll try my level best as a teacher to make things very simplified so that you can learn in a very comprehensive manner. So guys, that was all for today. And in the next video, let me show you a sneak peek what we'll be doing. We'll deal with a four bar mechanism, something like this. We'll be dealing with this four bar mechanism. Anyway, so that is going to happen in the next session. For now, take care, have a nice day, stay safe, keep learning, keep working. Thank you.